Thank you for listening to Depictions Media Radio.
The Honorable Leader of the Opposition.
After the summer the Liberals had, even the Prime Minister must admit that he's not worth the cost, Mr. Speaker. After 8 years of promising to reduce the cost of housing, it has doubled. And he said it's not his job. And finally, he panicked because of lower support in polls. He's recycled the same promises he broke over 6 years ago. It took 8 years to cause housing hell by the Prime Minister. How long will it take to resolve this? The Right Honorable Prime Minister. Mr. Speaker, we know that Canadians are feeling the rise in prices throughout the country, especially at the grocery store and for housing. That's why we are taking immediate action to build more housing by eliminating GST, by supporting small businesses and extending repayment, and by calling in food CEOs for a meeting today to ensure we reduce the cost of food. Our priority is to build an economy focused on the well-being of all Canadians, and that is what we will do every day in this House. The Honourable Leader of the Opposition. People can't have well-being when they're living in tents. After 8 years, the cost of housing has doubled, and now interest rates are going up faster than in our country's monetary history. Even the former finance minister, Liberal John Manley, said that interest rates are going up because of the deficits. This prevents people from building houses and buying them. Will he finally eliminate inflationary deficits that make interest rates go up and keep his promise to balance the budget? The Right Honorable Prime Minister. Mr. Speaker, actions count more than words, and we've taken action. We are building thousands of housing units in London, and we are reducing red tape. We are encouraging cities like Calgary to put forward more ambitious proposals, and we are ensuring that affordable apartments are built throughout the country by eliminating GST on their construction. And if food CEOs don't make your groceries more affordable, we will do so. This is what Canadians are calling for today, and that is what we are doing to build an economy that works for everybody. The Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, after the summer that these Liberals have had, even the Prime Minister must admit that he's not worth the cost. Yeah. 8 years after he promised to make housing more affordable, he doubled the cost, doubled the rent, doubled mortgage payments, doubled the needed down payment. Then he said housing is not his job. And then he panicked when he plummeted in the polls and recycled promises that he'd broken 6 years earlier. Mr. Speaker, it took him 8 years to cause this housing hell. How long will it take to fix it?
The Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Speaker, we said we'd work with municipalities to get housing built faster, and that's exactly what we're doing right across the country, including, for example, with the City of London, where we've got a deal done that fast-tracks the creation of over 2,000 additional housing units over the next 3 years, builds thousands more in the years to come. We're doing this by cutting red tape, fixing outdated zoning policies, and building more homes faster. This is our first deal, but I promise, not the last.
I'm here.
The Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
Speaker, he's building bureaucracy, not building homes. Yeah. In fact, his inflationary deficits drive up interest rates, according to former Liberal Finance Minister John Manley. And that ensures that it's harder not only to buy homes, but to build them. Today, we got the devastating news that not only are we not increasing home building was down in August, 18 months after his so-called accelerator was brought into place. But when will the Prime Minister realize that he's not worth the cost, get out of the way, and build homes, not bureaucracy?
You right, Honourable Prime Minister.
Speaker, the opposition leader's bickering won't help get houses built. Our plan does. The Minister of Housing wrote the Mayor of Calgary offering to partner with the city if they made necessary changes for more affordable housing. And just this Saturday, the City of Calgary approved a plan for reducing zoning red tape and building housing by public transit. This is a step in the right direction. We know together we can build more apartments for students to rent and more homes for families to grow in.
The Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, all he has delivered is an economy that built fewer homes last year than were built in 1972.
Wow.
And this year, housing construction is expected to drop further by 32%. Data from August showed that home building was down again. His inflationary deficits drive up interest rates, which make it harder for builders to finance their construction and harder for Canadians to afford a mortgage. So what will he finally do what he promised to do 8 years ago, and that is balance the budget to bring down interest rates and inflation?
The right Honourable Prime Minister.
On delivering real results while the leader opposite is focused on empty slogans and picking fights. In fact, when he was in charge of housing, he bungled projects like the Toronto Line 1 extension, which to this day has no housing near a number of its stations. In contrast, we are actually linking public transit dollars to apartments and housing density, and we're doing so without the Conservative plan to restrict access to abortion, to deny the impact of climate change, and put more assault weapons in our streets.
The Honourable Member for La Prairie.
I just want to remind the honourable members, the ones who used to sit way down there and now are over here, I can see you now as well as hear you. The honourable member, l'honorable...
The honourable member for La Prairie. Mr. Speaker, in the midst of the housing crisis, Quebecers want politicians to find solutions. But to date, politicians in Ottawa aren't finding solutions, they're finding scapegoats. They blame our cities in Quebec for their failures in Ottawa. But municipalities have pointed out that the federal government is withholding $900 million earmarked for housing during a housing crisis. Ottawa is depriving Quebec of $900 million and has been doing so for 6 months. Mr. Speaker, it's not a time for squabbling. It's a time for building. It's time to be responsible. Will the government immediately release our $900 million? The right honorable Prime Minister. Mr. Speaker, we are there to build in partnership with the provinces and municipalities. We're there to build more housing. That's why we created a $4 billion plan to accelerate densification, improve zoning, and help municipalities deliver more housing more quickly. We've also eliminated the GST on building new apartments because we know that we need to increase supply. We will continue to be there to work hand in hand with the provinces, with municipalities, because it's by all working together that we will address this housing crisis. The Honourable Member for La Prairie. Mr. Speaker, if housing is their priority, then they should free up the $900 million we're entitled to for housing construction. It doesn't get much more obvious than that. And yet the Liberals are doing the opposite. They're withholding the $900 million for housing. The message this sends to Quebecers who are having a hard time affording decent housing is that they're not the priority. They take second place to jurisdictional squabbles. Mr. Speaker, that's not responsible. That's not what Quebecers expect from the federal government. So when are the $900 million for housing going to be paid? The Right Honourable Prime Minister. On the contrary, Mr. Speaker, we know full well that the Bloc is here for squabbling. We are here to work hand in hand with the provinces, with municipalities. That's why we've set up a $4 billion plan to work directly with municipalities to increase supply in housing, to build more densification, to improve zoning, to accelerate construction of new housing. We've also removed the GST from construction costs for new apartments because we know how much we need to increase supply. That's part of the actions we've taken for a long time that we will continue to take to help people throughout the country. The Honourable Member for Burnaby South.
For 20 months, Canadians have been dealing with high grocery bills, and neither the leader of the opposition nor the Prime Minister have the courage to mention the true culprit, the corporate greed, which is driving up prices. In fact, when they have the chance to publicly show up and hold these CEOs to account, neither of them even bothered to show up. The leader of the opposition even gave tax breaks to the wealthy CEOs. When will the Prime Minister stop the delay and the disappointment? When will this government step up and force these CEOs to finally lower their prices?
The Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, our focus is on making life more affordable and ensuring corporations pay their fair share. The Minister of Innovation met today with the CEOs of the large grocery chains to reinforce the immediate need to stabilize food prices and improve competition. Indeed, we're introducing changes to competition here in Canada to address the rise in food prices, amongst others. We will every day, Mr. Speaker, continue to build an economy that works for all Canadians.
Well, member for Burnaby South.
Under the Liberals and the Conservatives, Canada has lost 1 million affordable housing units. And it's been 5 months that construction has been going down. Eliminating GST on the construction of affordable housing is important, but it's 8 years too late. It will take a lot more. When will the Prime Minister stop delaying and announce that the federal government is starting once again to build affordable housing? The Right Honourable Prime Minister. Mr. Speaker, our goal is to make people's lives more affordable and to ensure that corporations pay their fair share. The Minister of Innovation met with food CEOs this morning to insist on the need to stabilize the price of food and increase competition. We are making changes to the rules on competition in Canada to fight the rise in food prices, among other. We will continue to build an economy that works for all Canadians every day.
Le chef de l'opposition.
The NDP has now been in government for almost 2 years, during which time, by their own admission, both grocery prices and grocery profits have gone up. That's the result they get. And now they're supporting the Prime Minister's plan for a carbon tax that will rise to 61 cents a liter on the farmers who make the food and the truckers who ship the food. Their response to all this is to hold a big photo op today. The Prime Minister claims food will be affordable by Thanksgiving. So, will, by Thanksgiving, lettuce be back down from its 94% increase because of today's meeting?
The Honourable, Minister for Innovation.
To thank the leader of the opposition for his question, but coming from someone who advocated for crypto as an advice to Canadians, I think Canadians watching at home understand not to follow his advice when it comes to grocery, Mr. Speaker. The answer of Canadians is thanks, but no thanks, Mr. Speaker. We're going to continue to do the tough work on this side and fight for Canadians at every step of the way.
The Honourable Leader of the Opposition.
It's not just one carbon tax, there's a second carbon tax. that the Prime Minister wants to impose on the backs of Quebecers. Yes, it applies to Quebecers, to farmers, to truckers in Quebec who deliver our food. And the Bloc supports it and wants to increase it radically, as they've said. This will inflate the price of food. Will the Prime Minister heed the call of the Bloc to radically increase the carbon tax on the backs of Quebecers?
Honorable Minister.
The Honorable Minister of the Environment. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. As it's my first opportunity to speak during the session, I'd like to offer my sincerest condolences to all Canadians and people who were affected by forest fires, the tens of thousands of people who were evacuated due to forest fires, to flooding, and thankfully, Tropical Storm Lee didn't hit as hard as it could have. At a time of climate change, a responsible government has to invest in climate change, and it also needs to support Canadians during these difficult times. That's exactly what we're doing on this side of the House, Mr. Speaker. The Honourable Member for Mégantic-L'Érable. The Liberal Bloc carbon tax has radically increased the price of food. Carrots alone have gone up 74%. My mother always told me to eat carrots. They're good for your eyes. I invite the Bloc leader to eat more of them because he doesn't see the costs of his support for the Liberal Bloc carbon tax. The Prime Minister and his coalition with the Bloc are not worth the cost, Mr. Speaker. Will the Prime Minister's big meeting with food CEOs at least cancel the 74% increase for carrots by Thanksgiving? Yes or no? The Honourable Minister. Mr. Speaker, with the forest fire season we've had, the heat waves that have been throughout Canada and around the country, around the world, some people might say that there are bigger challenges than carrots. We need to fight climate change. We need to help people during these difficult times. That's exactly what we're doing here on this side of the House. What is the Conservative Party proposing? Nothing to fight climate change. They want pollution to be free. Mr. Speaker, that's not a responsible position for a party that wants to form government. The Honourable Member for Mégantic-L'Érable. We want groceries to cost less for everyone, Mr. Speaker. The carbon tax 2.0 that the Liberals are imposing on Canadians, contrary to what the Bloc Québécois claims, also applies to Quebec. On June 5th, a motion was presented in this House that the House recognizes that the first carbon tax is a failure and calls on the government to immediately cancel the second tax, the clean fuel regulations. And what do you know? The Bloc voted against it. Even worse, a Bloc MP called for a radical increase. Will the Prime Minister reject the Bloc's call to radically increase the carbon tax at the expense of Quebecers? The Honourable Minister. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'd like to remind my honourable colleague that in his party's election platform at the last election, he proposed putting in place a clean fuel program. That's exactly what we've done. This program leads to thousands of jobs, billions of dollars in investment throughout the country, and the Canadian Association of Petroleum Producers supported this. It would lead to jobs, especially in agriculture. What do the Conservatives have to fight climate change? Absolutely nothing.
Member for Foothills.
The thing is, Mr. Speaker, the Liberals can reduce the price of food right now if they abandon their failed carbon tax. But instead of taking any meaningful action, they are having more meaningless meetings. The price of diesel is already up 70 cents a liter, increasing the costs on farmers to produce the food, manufacturers to process it, truckers to haul it, and certainly for Canadians to buy it. When the price of lettuce is up 94%, clearly, the Prime Minister's NDP government isn't worth the cost. Will the Prime Minister's big meetings reduce the cost of lettuce by Thanksgiving? Yes or no?
The Honourable Minister of Innovation.
Mr. Speaker, I'd like to thank the member for the question. Instead of talking and talking, Mr. Speaker, they should look at what we've done today. Mr. Speaker, this is the first time in Canadian history that the grocer have come to Ottawa. Mr. Speaker, we had difficult discussions, but at the end of the day, those are discussions that needed to have in order to stabilize the price of food in Canada, Mr. Speaker. We have been very clear with the Prime Minister and the Minister of Finance. We are going to work with them to stabilize prices in Canada. That's what Canadians expect at home. That's what we're going to deliver.
Absolutely.
The Honourable Member for Foothills.
After 8 years of the Prime Minister's NDP government, Canadians can't afford to put food on the table. And it's getting worse. The Parliamentary Budget Office report on Friday stated by 2030, Canadian farmers will pay close to $1 billion in carbon taxes alone. Wow. Lettuce is up 94% because of these increases in carbon taxes. And the costs they're putting on farmers, processors, certainly truckers. And you know what? It's Canadians who are paying the price at the grocery store shelf. Now they want to quadruple that tax. How much will Canadians pay for a head of lettuce?
The Honourable Minister of the Environment.
I would like to read for you an extract from a press release from the Canola Growing Association, and which states, "We're pleased to see the clean fuel regulations provide options that will minimize regulatory burden and allow canola to be used to reduce greenhouse gas emissions through biofuel production. Recognition of sustainable practice of Canadian growers to help sequester and store carbon. Agriculturists are in favor of what we're doing, Mr. Speaker, to fight climate change and create a strong and vibrant Canadian economy."
The Honourable Member for Avignon-La-Métis-Matane-Matapédia. Mr. Speaker, climate collapse has begun. That is the devastating assessment of the Secretary General of the United Nations, the hottest July on record. Marine heat waves with global averages of 21 degrees, forest fires so numerous that it's as if everything between Ottawa and Quebec City had burned down. It's staggering. The situation affects everyone. Everyone. And it's not getting any better, because we're not acting responsibly. What is the government waiting for to take global warming seriously? The Honourable Minister. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I thank my honourable colleague for her question, and I share her concern on the matter of climate change, contrary to the Conservative Party of Canada. And I'd like to remind her that between 2019 and 2021, Canada is the G7 country that's had the best performance on reducing greenhouse gases. 55 million tons less. That's 25% of our goal for 2030 that we've accomplished. But I agree with her. We need to do more. We need to do it faster. And that's why the Prime Minister and myself and colleagues will be going to New York this week to work with all countries around the world to accelerate the fight against climate change. The Honourable Member for Avignon-La-Métis-Matane-Matapédia. Mr. Speaker, the government tells us that fighting climate change is a priority, but it's not. While the UN is talking about climate ambition, three ministers from this government are heading to Alberta for the World Petroleum Congress. They'll be talking about green oil, I imagine, to show how much respect they have for our intelligence. But the sad truth is that Canada is an oil country, and heating up the planet pays in this country. When will this government start acting responsibly and taking real action to combat global warming? The Honourable Parliamentary Secretary, we take climate change very seriously, doing the work we need to do. For the Congress, it's true that the Minister of Natural Resources is there. He's there to tell everyone that it's very important for us to do everything we need to do to decarbonize our energy systems. We need clean energy, we know that, and we are doing the work to get it. The Honourable Member for Avignon-La-Métis-Matane-Matapédia. Mr. Speaker, the unprecedented forest fires we've seen in Quebec, and that also happened in British Columbia, the Northwest Territories, and the Atlantic, are disastrous for the planet, for the people affected, for biodiversity, even for the economy. A disaster that is bound to happen again and again. But there's no Congress on fighting forest fires or on the energy transition. No. Here we welcome oil magnates with open arms. It's irresponsible, Mr. Speaker, totally irresponsible. How many more thousands of hectares will have to burn before the government wakes up? The Honourable Minister of the Environment. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I thank my colleague for her question. And that is why, faced with climate change and the increase in natural disasters, we've put forward the first national climate change adaptation plan in partnership with the provinces and territories, municipalities, and Indigenous people. A plan to adapt to climate change that was recognized by institutions like Impact Assurance that has said it's one of the best in the world. The Insurance Bureau of Canada has said the same thing. We need to be better prepared to face the impact of climate change. And contrary to the Conservative Party that still thinks it doesn't exist, we have a plan to fight climate change and to adapt to them.
For Mayor Rasheed, Grand Lake.
Mr. Speaker, gas, diesel, and home heating costs are spiking because Liberal MPs voted to implement and increase the carbon tax. The Prime Minister and his NDP coalition are not worth the cost to Canadians. After 8 years raising carbon taxes on the farmers and truckers that bring us our food, lettuce is up 94%. Now he wants to quadruple that tax to 61 cents a litre. How much more will that add to the price of lettuce?
The Honourable Deputy Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, what Canadians across the country need, what Canadians in Atlantic Canada need right now, is more homes to be built faster. And that's why last week the Prime Minister announced we are removing the GST on purpose-built rental. But do you know what the Conservative leader said about our housing plan? He said, we don't need more spending. I guess he thinks homes are going to get built by magic. We know we need home builders to invest more to build more faster. That's what our government is going to do in Atlantic Canada and across the country.
The Honourable Member for South Shore St. Margaret.
After 8 years, Nova Scotians are hurting because of the NDP Liberal carbon tax. It increases the cost to produce food, to process the food, to transport the food.
Yep.
One example is that the price of cabbage has gone up 70% because of the actions of these Liberals. The Prime Minister and his Liberal NDP government are not worth the cost. Will the Prime Minister's big meeting with grocery CEOs reverse this 70% price hike by Thanksgiving? Yes or no?
The Honourable Minister for Housing.
Speaker, my honourable colleague will know well that Nova Scotians are hurting for a number of reasons, including we are on the front lines of the fight against climate change. Over the course of the past year, we have seen Hurricane Fiona devastate our communities. We have seen floods sweep our neighbours away. We have seen wildfires like we have never seen before, and these things come at a cost. One of the interesting things about this argument, Mr. Speaker, is my colleague ignores the fact that one of the driving costs behind the increase in produce is climate change itself. Jurisdictions produce food cannot do it at the same place. We will put measures in place to help Nova Scotians struggling with affordability, and we will fight climate change at the same time.
The Honourable Member for New Brunswick Southwest.
Mr. Speaker, 60 cents. This is the price differential today for gasoline between the state of Maine and my province, New Brunswick. 60 cents a litre. For 8 years, Liberal MPs have voted to bring in and raise taxes on energy, and they voted to triple the carbon tax between now and 2030. This Prime Minister just is not worth the cost. His carbon tax on farmers has raised the price of carrots by 74%. Will the Prime Minister's big meeting with grocery CEOs bring down this 74% increase before Thanksgiving? Yes or no?
Honourable Minister for Innovation.
Mr. Speaker, I'm sure Canadians watching at home are feeling insulted by what they hear from this side, Mr. Speaker. At a time where Canadians are hurting, at a time when this nation needs to come together to fight food price inflation, at a time we call the CEOs to come to Ottawa to come with concrete solutions to stabilize prices, the Conservatives are choosing to be on the sidelines where we're acting on behalf of Canadians, Mr. That's Speaker. Right. I invite every member of this House to work with us, stabilize prices, and help Canadians at a time of
The Honourable Member for Rosemont La Petite Patrie. Mr. Speaker, we heard it throughout the summer. People are having a hard time paying for groceries. Prices are exploding. The big chains are making record profits and CEOs are lining their pockets. And what are the Liberals doing? Well, they're holding meetings. Like today, they said to the CEOs, look, if you're not nice, we will maybe one day give you a tap on the wrist. It's really not serious. The NDP leader is going to table a bill to give the Competition Bureau some teeth. It's a concrete, practical solution. When will the Liberals act to help people put food on the table? The Honourable Minister of Innovation. I have a lot of respect for my colleague, but I think he missed part of the message, Mr. Speaker, because that is exactly what we are doing. When we announced last week, Mr. Speaker, that we were going to make a huge reform of competition in this country, Mr. Speaker, we are going to give power to to the director of the Competition Bureau to require documents to hold legal investigations. We're going to take away the merger defense, which are not in the interest of Canadians, and we want to fight collaboration, which is hurting competition. What we are putting before Canadians is a plan for more competition, less consolidation, and lower prices.
For Nunavut.
Too many northern communities saw little to no housing projects or repairs this summer. Too many Nunavummiut are being denied their right to a home. When I visited Baker Lake this summer, I saw housing conditions well below acceptable standards. Last year, the government of Nunavut and the Nunavut Tungavik Incorporated submitted a joint budget request to build more homes. They are still waiting. When will this government properly invest in housing that will make a difference in people's lives?
The Honourable Parliamentary Secretary, the Honourable Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the member for her very important question. As she knows, housing is number one priority in the North, in the Arctic. In Budget 2022, we moved $4 billion for distinctions-based housing, including $800 million for Inuit Nunangat. In Budget 23, we have $4 billion for northern rural and urban housing. Mr. Speaker, we know we are making progress, but there's a lot of work to do. We will get it done.
Hear, hear.
The Honourable Member for Brampton South.
Mr. Speaker, I spoke with many residents in Brampton this summer, and I heard a lot about the need to build more homes faster in Canada. We know increasing supply is just one of the major solutions to the housing crisis. Can the Minister of Housing, Infrastructure and Communities tell us how removing GST on rental construction can help drive down the cost of housing?
Minister of Housing.
Mr. Speaker, I want to thank my honourable colleague, the Member of Parliament for Brampton South, for her advocacy for her community, and I enjoyed thoroughly my visit to the City of Brampton, where we worked directly with the Mayor and members of Council and the City to uncover what some of the plans they might advance to help grow the supply of housing in their community. But one of the things we've been hearing over the course of this summer is that we need to change the financial equation for builders to build. They are dealing with higher costs as a result of increased costs of supplies and materials, and they're operating in a higher interest rate environment. That's why I was thrilled when we were able to announce last week we will be getting rid of the GST on apartment construction in Canada to build more homes for Canadians. Mr. Speaker, what's more, we have seen provincial governments follow suit.
I'm sorry, the time is up. The Honourable Member for Thornhill.
Mr. Speaker, after 8 years, the Prime Minister and his coalition with the NDP are not worth the cost. Housing is worse than ever and worse than anywhere. Years of inflationary deficit, Canadians are getting crushed with housing costs. Mortgage payments are up 151%. That's more than $3,500 a month. And in Toronto, it used to take 25 years to pay off a mortgage, and now it takes 25 years to save for a down payment. So will the Prime Minister end his wasteful spending and eliminate his inflationary deficit that so Canadians can keep a roof over their head?
The Honourable Deputy Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, Mike Moffat called our housing plan announced by the Prime Minister last week hugely important. This will make the numbers work. The governments of Ontario, BC and Newfoundland have already followed suit. But what did the Conservatives say about this practical plan to get more homes built? They said, we don't need more spending. Well, how do they think we're going to get homes built in Canada? Is it by magic? We need home builders to invest more and build faster. That is what our government is making possible. That is what is going to fix the housing challenge.
The Honourable Member for Thornhill.
Speaker, let's play back the tape. In 2015, this Liberal Prime Minister pledged that Canada needs, quote, real change and affordable housing. 8 years after he created this housing hell, he says he's not responsible for housing. Housing prices have doubled. Rents have doubled. Higher taxes and more government spending equals higher inflation and higher interest rates. Canadians can see it. So why is it that the NDP Liberal government are the only ones who can't?
The Honourable Minister of Housing.
I find it fascinating to watch the Conservatives' line of questioning, because they certainly seem to think that they have the solutions to Canada's housing crisis, but when you actually look at what they're proposing, they're just tinkering around the edges with half measures that won't make a meaningful difference. Mr. Speaker, we are getting rid of the GST on apartment construction in this country, and provincial governments are following suit. We are advancing measures to change the way that cities build houses, so they build them next to transit stations, to colleges and universities, and we are going to require that they build them more densely. We have much more to come over the course of the fall, Mr. Speaker, but if you put our plan against theirs, it'll win 7 days a week.
The Honourable Member for Charlevoix-Haute-Saint-Charles. Mr. Speaker, after 8 years under this Prime Minister's, Canadians are doubly in difficulty. Housing prices have doubled, and the Bank of Canada has warned that mortgage payments could go up by over 40%. Remember, in the budget 2023, the Minister of Finance declared that one of the main goals of the budget was to not throw oil on the fires of inflation. When will the Prime Minister stop these inflationist policies so that Canadians can keep a roof over their heads? The Honourable Deputy Prime Minister. Canada has the lowest deficit of all the G7 countries, and DBRS Morningstar last week reaffirmed our AAA credit rating. At the same time, we know that we have to work for Canadians. That is why the Prime Minister announced last week that GST on new rental housing would be eliminated. That is why this morning, with my colleague, the Minister for Industry, we had a meeting with the CEOs of all the grocery stores, because we are there, we are working for Canadians, and we will continue to do that. The Honourable Member for Charlevoix-Haute-Saint-Charles. Mr. Speaker, does the Minister of Finance know that mortgage payments for an average house are now $3,560 a month? That's an increase of 151% since the Prime Minister came to power. In Montreal, people need to have a minimum salary of at least $113,500 to hope to buy a house. These increases are a direct result of the inflationist policies of this Liberal government. Will the government stop with its inflationist deficits so that Canadians can dream of one day affording a house? The Honourable Minister of Housing.
Monsieur President.
Mr. Speaker, if you want to see more housing in Canada, we need to see more investment in seeing housing being built.
The problem, they like to assign blame, but when it comes time to advance solutions, they're nowhere to be seen. They are nowhere to be seen. They are advancing half measures that will not make a meaningful lick of difference on the need to build housings at a rate we have never built before. We have removed taxes on home construction. We are changing the way that cities build homes, and we have made years worth of investments in affordable housing. We're going to continue to advance policies that make a difference. It's what Canadians deserve.
The Honourable Member for Rivière-des-Mille. Mr. Speaker, another example of just how far Ottawa will go to push Quebec aside. The federal government held a competition to design a monument to commemorate the role of our soldiers in Afghanistan. A jury of experts decided that it was the Daou team from Quebec that won, but the Liberals rejected the opinion of these experts. They have publicly admitted that Quebec won, but they're giving the contract to a firm from Ontario instead. Who in this government ordered that the Quebec team be pushed aside at any cost, even if it means breaking their own rules? The Honourable Minister of Veterans. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the monument to commemorate Canada's mission in Afghanistan recognizes the commitment and the sacrifice of our soldiers. Over 40,000 people participated in this mission. Veterans Affairs received comments from over 10,000 Canadians, particularly from veterans, people who participated in the mission, and they all agreed, or the majority agreed, that the concept should really meet their needs. And in the end, the concept from STIMSA group better reflects exactly what veterans wanted. Mr. Speaker, we will always be there to listen to our veterans. Thank you. The Honourable Member for Rivière-des-Mille. Mr. Speaker, it's very difficult to believe. The worst is that they're admitting it. This is what they wrote to Daou. Despite the fact that the jury designated your concept as the winner of the competition, the government has decided instead to give the contract to another team. So much for the jury, so much for the architects, and so much for the artists who worked on this for months and months, and even worse, so much for their own rules. Will the government correct this injustice and give the contract to the company that truly deserved it and that won the competition? The Honourable Minister of Veterans Affairs. Mr. Speaker, as Minister of Veterans Affairs, I think it's very important to make sure that we listen to our veterans, veterans who served during the mission in Afghanistan. And during this process, we heard comments from 10,000 Canadians, and a majority of those were people who served in the Afghanistan mission. And they told us very clearly that the submission from the STIMSA group truly represented what they wanted from this monument. We thank the committee, which did extraordinary work, but we want to make sure that we respect the wishes of veterans. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Member for Kildonan, St. Paul.
Canada has some of the most unaffordable housing in the world, Mr. Speaker, and that's after 8 years of this Liberal Prime Minister. Mortgages are up over 151%, with payments over $3,500 a month. 8 years of inflationary Liberal deficits driving up interest rates, and homes have become completely unaffordable in Canada. When will the Liberals end their reckless inflationary deficits so that Canadians can once again afford a place to live?
The Honourable Minister.
Mr. Speaker, why should Canadians trust the Leader of the Opposition on housing? Because when he had the file, he failed hard. In fact, a $300 million fund to build housing in First Nations set up by the leader himself built, wait for it, 99 houses. That's right. For every one house he and the Carper Conservatives built on reserve, Mr. Speaker, we've renovated or built nine. We can't afford his broken ideas.
The Honourable Member for Kildonan, St. Paul.
Coalition can deflect and make all the excuses they want, but the fact remains that after 8 years of massive Liberal deficits, driving up interest rates and driving up inflation, Canadians can no longer afford a place to live. In 2015, the average rent for a two-bedroom apartment was just over $1,100 a month. 8 years after these Liberals, $2,300 a month. That's the reality Canadians are facing under that Liberal minister. When will the Liberals end this costly NDP coalition and allow Canadians a place to live, Mr. Speaker?
Deputy Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, Canada has the lowest debt and deficit in the G7, and our AAA rating was reaffirmed by a ratings agency last week. But what we need to ask is, what would conservative austerity do to Canada? Do the Conservatives propose to cut our $200 billion investment in healthcare? Maybe they propose to cut our investment in early learning and childcare, which has already cut fees for parents by 50%. Or maybe it's dental care that they would go after. What we know for sure is Conservative austerity hurts Canadians.
Excellent. The Honourable Member for Chicoutimi-Lefjord. Mr. Speaker, after 8 years of this Liberal government, mortgage payments have gone up by 151%, and the average payment is now $3,560 a month. The Prime Minister said in 2020, and listen closely, we took on debt so that Canadians wouldn't have to. And yet, more than ever, Canadians and Quebecers are having a hard time making ends meet. When will the Prime Minister end his wasteful, useless spending and eliminate these inflationist deficits so that Canadians can keep a roof over their heads? The Honourable Minister. Mr. Speaker, first of all, I'd like to thank the Prime Minister for his confidence. It's the first time that I've risen in this House as Minister, so thank you. And Mr. Speaker, what Quebecers need is a Prime Minister who thinks about them and who works closely with municipalities, not a leader from the opposition who treats municipal leaders as if they're incompetent, with condescension and arrogance. As a former Montreal councillor, I'm outraged to see how the Leader of the Opposition does not take into account the opinions of municipal leaders. The Honourable Member for Châteauguay-Lacolle. Mr. Speaker, in recent months, Canadians have lived through a series of extreme events, including forest fires, drought, heat waves, flooding, and violent storms, which have caused incredible destruction and which have affected the lives of many people across the country. This week, Canada will be in New York for the UN Climate Week. Can the Minister of Environment and Climate Change please tell us what Canada will be putting forward at the General Assembly of the United Nations. The Honourable Minister of the Environment, thank you. I'd like to thank my colleague for her question and for her hard work on this file. It's a pleasure for me to pass time with her and her constituents who are concerned about climate change and about protecting our natural habitats and about fighting pollution, including plastic pollution. And that's why the Prime Minister, along with some of our colleagues, will be going to New York to work with our colleagues to find solutions to these three major issues. In 2023, only in working on these three issues can a government be considered serious. We will continue to work on these.
For Oxford.
Throughout the summer, I've heard heartbreaking stories from families across Oxford who are struggling to put food on their tables. After 8 years of this Prime Minister, this Liberal NDP government is not worth the cost. Their carbon tax has raised the cost of food. For example, the price of onions is up 69%. Will this Prime Minister's big meeting with grocery CEOs reverse the 69% hike by Thanksgiving? Yes or no?
The Honourable Minister for Housing.
Mr. Speaker, let me begin by congratulating the Honourable Member on taking his spot in this House. Having only recently arrived, Mr. Speaker, he can be forgiven if he's not aware that the party he now forms a member of voted against many of the measures that, in fact, make a direct impact on having life more affordable for his constituents. This includes investments in the Canada Child Benefit. This includes new investments that reduce the cost of childcare. This includes new benefits to provide dental care for low-income families. And this includes a rebate that leaves 8 out of 10 families in the province of Ontario better off as a result of putting price on pollution. We can fight climate change and make life more affordable. It's what we've been doing for 8 years, and we're going to.
The Honourable Member for Calgary Heritage.
For my neighbours across Calgary, senior savings are going up in smoke. Single moms may not be in the homes of the doors that I knocked, and the dreams of young couples and newcomers devastated. Mr. Speaker, the Prime Minister and his NDP government have not been worth the cost. After 8 years of raising carbon taxes on the farmers and truckers who bring us our food, potatoes are up 68%. Now he wants to quadruple the carbon tax to 61 cents a liter. How much more will that add to the price of potatoes?
The Honourable Minister of Health.
Responsible to a weary planet that is going through some of its darkest days is although Canada has some of the lowest food inflation and some of the slowest inflation in the world, it is so much more that we have to do. But saying to people who are facing the global challenge of inflation that cutting dental care, that taking away dental care from vulnerable families is a solution to global inflation and the crises that we face, show this.
The Honourable Member for Calgary Heritage, it's his first day here. I'm sure he wants to hear the answer to his question. And we really can't hear it with all the shouting that's going on. So I'm going to ask the Honourable Minister of Health to start from the top so that the Honourable Member can hear the answer.
Mr. Speaker, in all times of great challenge globally, there is a responsibility for all of us to focus on solutions and answers. And yes, it's incredibly easy on the other side and point out what's wrong in the world and what's happening, but there are solutions, cutting support and services from the most vulnerable. Let me just talk about dental care for a second. Do you know the number two cause of children in a hospital? Oral health, all of which is preventable. We could stop people from getting ill. We could take action to make our world better, or we can throw around slogans like what is being done on the other side. Let's focus on real answers, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Member for Portage-Lisker.
Thank
few fries short of a Happy Meal.
Mr. Speaker, when I was talking with friends and neighbors this summer, I heard loud and clear that people can't afford the Liberal NDP government's carbon tax. The average farm family will spend an extra $150,000 each year. The people who make the food can't afford that, and the people who buy the food can't afford that. This Prime Minister is simply not worth the cost. After 8 years, the Prime Minister has driven up the cost of everything, and Canadians have had enough. When will the Prime Minister listen to Canadians and finally axe the tax?
The Honourable Minister of Agriculture.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I appreciate my honourable colleague's question. But the fact is, when you look at what happened in our area of the country, Fiona alone, it destroyed burns, it killed cattle, it destroyed wharves. The fact is that it was, if we don't deal with the economy, the cost of everything will go up. We have invested in climate change, and this government will continue to invest in climate change, so we will have a place to live. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Member for King's Hants.
This summer, it has become abundantly clear to Canadians the challenges that climate change and extreme weather is presenting. In King's Hants, we sadly lost four individuals in our communities with flash floods which have not been seen in 50-plus years. The importance of real-time emergency alerts to cell phones is so important, but cell reception in some of my communities is simply non-existent. Will the Minister of Emergency Preparedness commit to working with the Minister of Industry to push the CRTC and telecoms to improve cell service for communities where no service exists in the interest of their safety and well-being? Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Minister for Emergency Preparedness.
I want to thank my colleague for this very important question. I want to take the opportunity to pass on my sincere condolences to the families who lost loved ones during the flash floods in July. Not every second counts in an emergency, Mr. Speaker, and Canadians need to be informed as quickly as possible when there is a threat to their safety. A public alerting system is an absolute priority for our government. We will be speaking to the appropriate agencies, and I'll be working with the provinces and territories, and especially municipalities, to making sure that we have the right system for Canadians. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for South Okanagan, West Kootenay.
Mr. Speaker, this summer over 16 million hectares of forests burned. More than 200,000 Canadians were forced to flee their homes. To call this wildfire season unprecedented is an understatement. And with off-the-charts global temperatures, we can expect climate change to deliver even more extreme wildfires. It's clear that Canada's wildfire response was overwhelmed. Waiting for help from overseas costs valuable time and money, and the Liberals don't seem to be rushing to fix it. Will the minister support our call for a national wildfire fighting service which can be deployed immediately where needed?
The Honourable Minister.
Colleague, that climate change is having a devastating impact across the country, especially in British Columbia. And the member opposite and I actually toured Soyuz together and saw the impacts directly, where a wildfire actually was close to a neighbor, just 1 meter away, and we thank all the firefighters for their amazing work. But we need to make sure, Mr. Speaker, we have the right resources at the right place at the right time, and that's what we're committed to doing. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Saanich Gulf Islands.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and to the Honourable Member for Emergency Preparedness. We have to do far more. We know that not only, as the member for King's Hants says, the cell service is inadequate, cell service goes down even where you have it during climate emergencies. We lose power, we lose landlines. We need a national firefighting force, a national water bomber fleet, and a permanent national task force for climate emergency preparedness, for better warnings, better communications, and better response time. Will the minister set up such a task force immediately?
The Honourable Minister.
Mr. Speaker, I look forward to working with my colleague on this. Look forward to meeting with her and listening to her ideas. Every time we've had an emergency and disaster across this country, year after year, our folks have continually learned and we applied those lessons regularly. And this year in particular, where we had floods, wildfires, and even hurricanes at our doorsteps, Mr. Speaker, we will learn from those, put the appropriate resources in place, and I'll be focused on, again, Mr. Speaker, making sure that we have the right resources at the right place at the right time. Thank you.
I'm afraid that's all the time we have for question period today. À la suite de discussion.
I'll just be very brief. Thanks for that, Sam. I'm just so delighted to be part of the delegation welcoming the world to Alberta. I think this is a really exciting conference, an exciting theme about how to achieve carbon neutrality by 2050. I found already with many of the speakers, although not all, that we are very much in sync with the pathway and with some of the new innovations that are going to happen to get there. Had a fantastic opportunity to tour the Saudi Arabian pavilion and look at all of the amazing new developments that they have on how to capture and sequester CO2 and turn it into useful products. So I think you're going to see a race between Alberta and some of these other jurisdictions to make sure we can adopt the same technologies. And as I mentioned in my speech last night, and I think this bears repeating over and over again, that this whole enterprise we've started on is a pathway to reduce emissions. We are transitioning away from emissions. We're not transitioning away from oil and natural gas. So with that, I'd be happy to take any questions.
Yeah, if you guys prefer to step down, we can also raise hands. I'll go with you, Sean, as well.
Go ahead. Sean Poulsen, Western Standard. I don't know if you sat in on Mr. Nasser's presentation this morning.
I did.
And he was talking about potentially dangerous energy transition. And I'm wondering what some of your thoughts were and maybe how it applies here.
Well, I think that what I liked about what he had to say was talking about how we have to make sure that as we're transitioning, we're also keeping an eye on affordability and reliability. I mean, we have a lot of disruption that happens in the world when people feel economically insecure. And so I think he was just commenting on some of the things that we've seen in the past, and that you have to build out the new energy system at the same time as maintaining the existing energy system so that you have that continuity. And I think he's very pragmatic. I think it's very much along the lines of what we would like to see. Having an aggressive target of getting to 2050, that is aggressive. And it doesn't mean that you can't have milestones along the way. But I think his caution was to make sure that we put people first and that we care about people and that we're very mindful of energy poverty and the kind of turmoil that can cause if we're not mindful of that. And I agree with him.
And with respect to your remarks at the opening ceremony yesterday about we don't want to be like Germany, can you expand on that?
I was just, someone just shared with me another story today about how Germany is turning a wind farm, decommissioning a wind farm, so that they can recommission a coal plant. And that's what happens when you end up making a decision to move faster than the technology is able to keep up. Energy security and affordability is the imperative of governments to make sure that they can maintain. And what we don't want to see is that because we're looking for a perfect solution, that we're not looking at what the transition needs to be. And the transition has to involve LNG, has to involve natural gas. We can continue to work towards better and better carbon capture technology. But when I talk to those who are looking for that transition and looking for Canada to play a role in exporting LNG, they're very clear with me that if we don't do our part and they can't get that secure supply of natural gas, they're going to recommission coal plants. And if that happens, that increases global emissions. And I think that moves us backwards. So we don't want to be in the position that Germany is, where they have to take a U-turn because they didn't end up with the reliability and affordability being front and center.
So I don't want to jump from the cameras there, sorry. But just on the emissions cap, obviously that's something that's very much front and center here. What does Alberta want to see at that? You know, Wilkinson's saying we'll probably have something by the end of the year. What do those negotiations look like as far as you're concerned?
Well, we have an 8 to 12 month time frame, and I don't want to prejudge what the outcome would be. I mean, keep in mind, we already do have an emissions cap in Alberta on oil sands. It's 100 megatons. And it was a generous cap because I think there was a recognition that the industry was going to keep on working on reducing emissions. I mean, if we're all working towards carbon neutrality by 2050, my view is we don't actually need an emissions cap. My view is that we should be working towards carbon neutrality by 2050 and figuring out what those abatement curves look like for each industry. Some industries are going to get there faster than others. And putting arbitrary targets in place before talking to industry and doing that modeling, that seems to be a bit premature. So I'm hopeful that we don't see, and I've said this to our federal counterparts, is they keep on threatening things like the clean electricity regs, making having those implemented, the oil and natural gas emissions cap, a methane target that is aggressive. Those are all things that have to be negotiated. And if they were to come through with those policies while we're at the table, we would look at that as a negotiating in bad faith. We don't want that.
And just one of my colleagues sent me a question on E. coli, whether or not you'll commit to a public inquiry, and why do you think Preston Manning is the appropriate person to oversee any kind of review of the Public Health Act, given his anti-science background with no public health experience?
Well, a couple things. Yes, I have committed to do a review. I'm not quite sure what form that will take just yet. I want to make sure that we've gotten through the worst of the crisis. I'm very relieved to see that the number of hospitalizations have gone down from 12 to 9, and the number of kids on dialysis has gone down from 4 to 3, and the cases appear to be stabilizing. I believe we're at 348 today. So we're at a point very soon where we'll be able to shift into looking at that review. So yes, I have committed to that, and we will do one. I had asked Preston Manning to look at the full range of legal changes that might be necessary in looking at what the next pandemic response should be. And so Public Health Act is one part of it, but there's, I think, about 7 or 8 other pieces of legislation that he is looking at.
Good afternoon, Premier. You often talk about how, you know, Alberta is advancing its position on oil and gas, and, you know, things are going not that badly. But oftentimes, Albertans and Canadians see that there's a lot of evidence, perhaps to the contrary, that keeps arising, whether it's comments made by the Minister for Climate Change, or in the case of the Minister of Natural Resources, comments he made last night, which you definitely very strongly took objection to. So where are we really at when, on the one hand, you are saying you're bargaining in good faith, negotiating in good faith, everything's, you know, we're going to try to get things ironed out, and incessantly we keep on getting these disagreements along the way as to what's actually happening and where it's all going to end up?
Where I think we agree is carbon neutrality by 2050. Where we disagree is what the milestone should be along the way. And, you know, I appreciate that there does need to be some demonstration that we're moving in the right direction. I think we have demonstrated that. The conversion from coal to natural gas resulted in, I think it was 22 megatons of emissions reduction. The aggressive targets that we set to reduce methane emissions, we've achieved that target of 45% emissions reduction. So we've also been the first to put carbon pricing on industrial emissions. That was done back in 2007. We also have at-scale projects for carbon capture, utilization, and storage that are working. We've got the carbon trunk line. We've got major industrial players that are talking about their pathway to get to net zero. So I feel like we are demonstrating that we are taking those steps. And it's a matter, I think, of getting the federal government to acknowledge that this that's progress. And there's just certain things we have to work with the federal government on. I know that the Prime Minister is very keen on the issue of small modular nuclear. And I'm keen to work with him on that too, but we've never had nuclear in this province. And so that requires broad-based consultation. It requires figuring out the regulatory pathway for that. Most of the existing sites were approved with an environmental permit decades ago, and the world has changed quite a bit. So we can move as fast as they can move, as long as we have some, as long as we're in sync on wanting to get the regulation streamlined. But we recognize we have to make progress. I think if we're focused on 2050, and then if we can get the regulations in sync, I think we'll be able to carve out those abatement curves and come to an agreement.
If you can't get those regulations in sync, and that's a hypothetical, but given the evidence, it could be a stronger than weaker hypothetical, is your government, you've made comments in the past, including, I remember, at the after the meeting with Prime Minister Trudeau at the Stampede, are you going to stand firm in Alberta's position on the 2035 and on the emissions cap? And secondarily, do you think it's helpful, the comments that are coming out of federal cabinet?
I don't know if anyone was in the room last night, but lead balloon might describe the way the energy ministers or the natural resources ministers' comments went over. To come to a major energy conference, an international energy conference, with people from all different backgrounds, many of them facing energy poverty in their own countries, and talking to producers about the ludicrous IEA projections that we're only going to have 25 million barrels of oil per day produced in 2050. I mean, it was a bit of a slap in the face, let's be frank about that. And that's why I had to indicate that I don't believe that those projections are accurate. I was pleased to see, actually, that the head of Saudi Aramco also said the same thing, that the company, or the IEA, has turned from being an entity that does predictions to being one that engages in political advocacy. And that isn't, I don't think that that's very helpful to the discussion. So my view is that we have an obligation to address issues of energy poverty, and that includes in our own province. When I hear and see what happens to our seniors and our vulnerable and our fixed income individuals in January, February, March, when you have not only a spike in home heating prices, but a spike in power prices, we can't allow that to continue. We've looked at this, at the numbers, and if we were to just allow for the natural capital turnover, it would be $92 billion by 2050. If we were trying to compress that, not only would it cost that $92 billion, it would cost an additional $52 billion to be able to achieve that goal within the next 13 years. And that could be anywhere from 2 to 5 times increasing the cost of electricity. That's just not affordable, not attainable. And we should be mindful that when you end up with that kind of hardship that you're putting on our most vulnerable citizens, there's going to be a backlash. So if we can avoid that, have a longer time frame, allow for the technology to develop, that seems to me to be the right pathway. So yes, we're going to stand firm. We cannot do net zero power grid by 2035. We think we can by 2050. Some of our producers say it can be done by 2045. So there might be some room for negotiation and discussion there, but we have to have every one of our decisions based in reality.
And the emissions cap?
And the emissions cap, again, as I mentioned, we already have an emissions cap on the oil sands, and the oil sands have responded to that. They have a pathway to be net zero by 2050 as well. Dow Chemical is going to have a petrochemical plant when they get to final investment decision that's net zero. Air Products is net zero hydrogen. The Heidelberg is going to have the first net zero cement plant in the world as well. And when you hear with cement being the second most used commodity behind water in the world, that's significant to be able to have that kind of engineering and pioneering innovation happening in Alberta. That's what we should be celebrating.
We're going to go to Chris next, and while he's asking his question, can I just get hands up for those questions as well?
Premier, you mentioned here that you obviously have a disagreement with Minister Wilkinson's speech, but what specifically did you disagree with? Why did you say, or why are you describing it as a bit of a slap in the face?
Well, I can tell you the number of people who walked up to me after he had spoken to see if I had steam coming out of my ears. That was one indication. I can tell you my cabinet was very unhappy with the comments that were made. And members of council were unhappy with the comments that were made as well. Because I think what he was tone deaf to is the amount of work that's been done by our industry to align with the carbon neutral target, and to essentially act as if the industry was winding down. And that is not the case. That's why I had to counter his message. This is not an industry that's winding down. It's an industry that's transitioning away from emissions. And the fact that we saw other speakers talking about in the same terms suggests to me that it was Minister Wilkinson who was offside on it.
Just to follow up, and this is a bit of a two-parter, but can you tell me, is this really the appropriate place on an international stage for the federal government and the provincial governments to be accused of energy policy? So that's my first question. The second one is, I heard that you had a conversation with the Saudi energy minister. Can I ask you just what you discussed and what the common ground is with his country?
Well, I don't like to fight with my federal counterparts, but I'm not going to allow them to take swipes at our industry and have it go unanswered. And talking about this industry winding down, being on its last legs, only having 25 million barrels a day of production by 2050, at a time when everybody's here to celebrate production and investment, and we're trying to make Canada an investment magnet, I would say that was the wrong place for him to make that speech. And I had to give people some optimism and enthusiasm that we are going to be able to work together to get to common targets. So I think I had to counter his comments because I think he left a pretty I think the room was pretty gloomy after he spoke, and I don't think there's anything to be gloomy about at all with this industry. I did speak to the Saudi energy minister. I had a chance to meet him this morning when he flew in, and we've had one of the things that I noticed about the pavilion is they're being very progressive on what they can do with captured CO2 to turn it into useful products. They have a product. I encourage all of you to go over there because they're using the CO2 to create a product that can be a replacement for rebar. They have a number of different plastic pipes that they can use. They're doing CO2 embedded in cement to be able to make stronger concrete. And they're also got a combustion engine hydrogen vehicle that they're working on as well. So I feel like we're going to be in a bit of a technological and innovation race with Saudi Arabia. And I think we heard that from the energy minister this morning. He intends to lead the world in this, and he is challenging the rest of us to keep up. And Alberta wants to keep up. So I think that there's going to be a lot of information sharing as we move towards a carbon neutral target.
Go to our front left here first. Yes.
I know this kind of relates to the industry and the federal government, but there's like a lot of negotiation right now going on regarding the degree of tax credit subsidies for carbon capture, but we're hearing that, you know, that they've got to get this thing going by the beginning of the year, or they're not even going to meet their own targets. I'm wondering, is the province doing anything? What are you doing to try to hurry this along, or something?
Well, I have mentioned that we're working on our own credit for carbon capture utilization and storage, similar but structured perhaps a little bit differently than our Alberta Petrochemical Incentive Program. And I want to be able to announce what the details of that are when I go to Dubai for COP28. So we accept that timeline is accelerated, and we're hoping that the federal government will be able to match us so that we can make a joint announcement together in Dubai.
Next year?
No, this year.
This year, sorry.
Yeah, sorry, that's going to be, I'll be traveling there November 30th, so it's the first week of December I'll be there.
Premier,
there are plenty of other forecasters in the IEA who are calling peak oil demand in the next 5 to 10 years. What if you're wrong? Is there a plan B?
Well, I guess the way I look at it is I like what the energy minister had to say. The Saudi energy minister had to say this morning. You've got to live in the real world, not on computer models. And he actually challenged the group to find a single time that the IEA has had a single projection that has been correct. So I think it takes a leap of faith to think that if they've never been correct, that they will be correct by 2050. We've got to respond to the world as it is, and I think he also was being quite responsible in saying that's part of the reason why they already did a production cut, is that there were predictions last year about how China was just going to race ahead once the COVID restrictions were lifted. Well, it turned out not to be the case. And his advice was, you take a measure of prudence so that you don't end up creating disruption and instability in the markets, and then you can always increase. And so I think that that kind of approach actually is a lot more practical than trying to rely on predictions from what has become, increasingly, unfortunately, a political activist organization.
And
Sinopec just the other day called for peak gasoline demand in China at the end of this year, peak diesel demand at the end of 2025. We've got Bloomberg NEF calling for peak road transport demand by 2026. It's global. It's not just the IEA. And you've got the Chamber of Commerce here in Calgary saying that the energy transition is an existential crisis for the Alberta oil and gas industry. Are you listening to other voices?
I would say one of the things I'm encouraged by is the same thing that the Saudi energy minister is encouraged by, all the ways in which you can use the product for different ends. I mean, they're talking about right now having 2 million barrels a day being used for alternative products, including lubricants, petrochemicals, and construction materials. And they're anticipating that's a double. So they're anticipating that as the amount of gasoline and diesel demand declines, they'll just replace that with non-combustion uses of their product. And we should be taking the same attitude as well. If we can use natural gas and oil to be able to create construction materials, harder cement, replacement for rebar. Why wouldn't we do that? That's how I'm looking at it, is that we're not going to phase out production of oil and natural gas. We're just going to change the way in which we use it. In our province, hydrogen is very likely going to be an increasingly important fuel that comes from natural gas as its base. Carbon capture, utilization, and storage will be able to assist in that development. And that's where I think we're going to end up going here. Hydrogen is also possible to be used for power plants. I think that's going to be a positive use also. And when you look at the supply for asphalt, I mean, I've seen some projections that we have the potential to increase our bitumen for use as asphalt up to 5 million barrels per day. So whether you're driving a combustion engine vehicle or a hydrogen combustion engine vehicle or a fuel cell vehicle or an EV, you're going to need roads to drive on. So those are the things that I'm looking at, is I don't think that the need for our products is going to diminish. I just think it's going to change.
Colette Doris, Canadian Press. Just back to the E. coli outbreak, we now have about 7 other facilities that have been either closed or partially closed due to this outbreak. What do you know about that so far in terms of how they relate to these other cases? And I'll just ask my second question as well. How does the provincial program to give a one-time reimbursement apply to those parents?
There's a couple of things I'd say. The secondary closures are related to having children interacting with each other. So all of them, as I understand it, have had some close contact with the child who was impacted or affected, or it was a child who was at one of the original facilities who got moved into one of the new facilities. So that's why we're telling parents is just make sure that you keep your kids at home if they're sick, and make sure that you go through the process of getting the clearance before having them return. I think we're now at 642 kids who are cleared to return. And so we'll go through that process. We'll have a lot more who are cleared to return in the coming weeks. The one-time payment was designed to be for those first 11 schools, daycares, because the trauma for those parents, the disruption for those parents, the financial hardship for those parents, and the lack of confidence some of those parents have in returning their kids to school. We wanted to make sure that all of that had a payment so that they could make the choices that is right for their family. At the moment, we haven't extended it to the partial closures on the other facilities. We are hopeful that those will be reopened very quickly. And so I understand the health minister will have more to say on that on Wednesday.
That if the federal government introduced the clean electricity standards during negotiations, that would be seen as a bad faith tactic. So how would the province respond? Would the idea of the CCUS tax credits go out the window? What would the next step be?
I'm going to be hopeful that they have heard my message loud and clear, not to bring any permanent changes through until we get to the end of the negotiations. We have a really good relationship with many of the ministers, and I think everybody is coming to the conclusion that having this negotiation in public is not serving the interests of either of our governments, and it's not serving the interests of industry. So I'm hoping we can bring the temperature down. I don't want to escalate it any further. I'm looking for the federal government to be measured in the comments that they make and optimistic in the comments that they make, and then we'll see where it goes from there. But you know, we've got a lot of mechanisms that we can use in order to be able to defend our constitutional right to develop our resources in our own way, not have the federal government put in production caps. Electricity is also an area that is provincial jurisdiction, exclusive provincial jurisdiction, and we intend to vigorously defend our constitutional rights.
Often with Global News. I just wanted to ask, we have a hearing underway right now elsewhere in Calgary, a TMX hearing, as they look at potentially additional costs, additional delays to this project. It was under $5 billion when the federal government first purchased it, now looking at over $30 billion. What kind of precedent does this set for other, you know, oil companies or other investors that are looking at putting pipelines into our province?
Well, the reason TMX ended up with a federal owner is because it needed to be de-risked. It was not going to go ahead without a federal partner. And I suppose once this is complete, we'll all learn from why it is it escalated so much. I'm just hopeful that it gets to the finish line before the end of next year, because it's still a viable project. It is still going to be a profitable project for all levels of government. And there's a really great opportunity for Indigenous partners to have an ownership stake and create a new revenue stream. So I'm really hopeful that they manage to figure out the routing issue. I know that it's complicated, could add, I think I read up to 9 months more to the process. So from what I've seen, the federal government is very keen to get it finished. They are now invested so much in this, they want to have it complete so that they can move it back into the private sector as quickly as possible. And we'll be prepared to assist on that. We already have our Alberta Indigenous Opportunities Corporation on standby, waiting to see if there's some way that we can assist in helping Indigenous communities take an ownership stake. So that work is already beginning. But once it gets into operation, we'll be able to kick in and provide some support to get that transition.
Another big story, of course, in the headlines. The Calgary City Council has approved its housing strategy over the weekend. Several recommendations involve the province on things like rent control, tax breaks for nonprofit affordable housing providers. What can Calgarians expect from the province now that the strategy is approved, and how open is the province to some of the ideas in this plan?
Well, I can say we're not going to do rent control. We know that that is the exact opposite of what we need to do. If you're trying to convince more developers to invest more money into building more rental housing, and then saying your reward for that will be that government will step in at any point and limit the amount you can charge, is going to have the exact opposite effect. So I know that it seemed to be a nice quick solution, but it actually creates more long-term problems. What we need is to increase supply. We are prepared to give more rent supplement programs. So we did add an additional 1,500 Alberta households to our rent supplement program, so there's a total of 12,500. Happy to work with Jason Nixon, our minister, to see if more needs to be done there. Last week, we announced $16 million to bring back affordable housing units for use across the province, and that's on top of $94 million we announced in Budget 2023. We also have $9 billion with our partners over the next 10 years to build 25,000 new units by 2031. But what I'm really most interested in, so that I think on the affordable side, I think that there's lots that we can do to work with our municipal counterparts. What I am interested, though, is that the strategy also includes 80 recommendations to reduce barriers to home building. And so attainable housing is just as important as affordable housing. You need to have young people know that aspirationally they're going to be able to buy a house. And so if that involves identifying provincial lands or provincial buildings that can be repurposed in the same way that municipal government is doing that. I think they've asked us to give a property tax reprieve for a period of time on new construction. I'm open-minded in looking at that. We also need to streamline the permitting process, though, too. I mean, there are some jurisdictions that are doing a great job on this. St. Albert, they proudly talk about how they can do same-day business license, 3-day development permits, and 3-week building permits. That's setting the kind of pace that I think we need to see from all municipalities about how urgent this is, that they clear away the barriers to construction. We also have an obligation to make sure that there are enough workers in this field as well. So I've met with the building trades to see what we can do to collaborate on introducing young people to the building trade sooner. And so if we can come to some agreement on how we might be able to accelerate that, I think that's going to address it too.
We just have time for one last question. We're just going to go to our back right here.
Premier, your comments yesterday or your speech, you talked about prioritizing and the importance of ethical production. I'm just wondering, given the ribbon cutting which just took place with your Saudi counterparts, their human rights violations are often well documented in question. Just how you justify that relationship?
One of the things that I think is important is to focus on the things that we agree on. And as the energy minister said, we agree on 85% of the direction that we need to go. We're welcoming people from all around the world, from a bunch of different backgrounds, but we're all here with the same purpose. We know that we have to deal with emissions in an urgent basis, but we also have to make sure that we're dealing with reliability and affordability and energy security. And so if we can work together on those, I know that the federal government is working on trying to reestablish a relationship with our Saudi counterparts after 5 years of of distance, and so we want to be supportive of trying to move in that direction. So we tend to try to focus on the areas where we can agree.
Thank you. And did you have a follow-up?
That's all.
Okay.
Thanks,
and
everyone.
Thank you, everybody, for trying.
This show has been produced by Depictions Media. Please contact us at depictions.media for more information.